All attempts in our world to change the rules so that people of God face a choice: compromise or face the consequences.
What's your passion? What is something that you really feel strongly about that you need to do something about?
The prediction in the Old Testament of the coming of Jesus was with remarkable accuracy. The same with the second coming of Jesus. And this same God allowed himself to be nailed to a cross to save you.
Oh, glorious day. praise you. We lift your name up high, Lord, for that whole story of your gospel. You came from heaven on high. You chose to come to earth to lower yourself, to live in our shoes, to die for us. But Lord, on that third day, you rose again. And that's a glorious celebration and a hope that we can have because you died for us and our sins. In your holy, precious name, amen.
Well, good morning. Are you ready for this? It's been a big morning. I know there's, you won't put any confidence in the fact that I say I'm going to do the shorter version, will you? I'll try. We've already had a big day. We're going to finish our series in the book of Daniel today. We've been in it for 3 months now. We started Daniel 1 to 6 back in October last year. And today we're going to just do a quick overview of everywhere we've been because it's been 3 months. So I've entitled this message, Your Kingdom Come. And you can tell from the scriptures that I've shown from the book of Daniel that there's a particular emphasis in what we're going to look at today. They've just come straight out of the text. It's just an area that I think, as we consider what's the whole point of the book of Daniel, I think that we'll find some support as we consider this. One of the problems that we have in life, and we've even seen it in the songs that we've sung this morning, we've mixed a lot of metaphors. We've talked about heaven, we've talked about the kingdom of God, we've talked about in the twinkling of an eye we're going to be changed. We've got lots of things that we talk about, and we say when we say, well, we're talking about the kingdom of heaven, we're talking about the kingdom of God. And one of the problems is that the writers sometimes interchange some of these terms. And so one of the problems is we actually don't really know what it is we're living for. Like, well, I'm supposed to be living for the kingdom of God, but I'm not really sure what that is. I think I know what it is, but then I read something else and it says the kingdom of God's like this. And then I read something else and it sounds like the kingdom of God's like that. And I'm like, which is it? We don't really know what we're living for. We know there's some kind of promised paradise. We get that much. We're living for a promised paradise, but when asked, what are you actually living for? I don't know. You know, if we ask someone who's not a Christian, what are they living for? One of the common phrases they'll use is, I'm living to make a difference. I want to make a difference in the world. Other people would say something like, well, I'm living for my family. I'm living for a future, a legacy. I want to leave something behind. They might say something else. But a Christian can answer with an equally kind of vague idea when we talk about what is it we're living for. We can say something like, well, I'm living for eternity. Whatever that means. I mean, we think we know life without end, but we haven't seen it yet. And we got a bit of a description of it in Revelation 21, but a lot of people think that's all metaphors and it's not actually, so kind of like, well, it sounds pretty good. But can't actually really say what that is. I know one young person I spoke to about eternal life said, why on earth would you want to live forever? And you know what? If here and now and the way things are is all there was, why would you want to live forever? If something doesn't change, who would want eternal life? In fact, a lot of movies are made about that whole idea of eternal, you know, people who somehow stayed immortal and they lived and they saw everybody around them die and they saw everybody around them, they saw the wars and they lived through all these things. And that would be a terrible thing, wouldn't it? To be immortal, live forever. So it's obviously more than eternal life. I think in our world today, because of this, there's a loss of hope because people don't know what they're living for. And even Christians can lose hope because we don't really know what we're living for. You know, many of our young people
are entering a world that they believe they're never going to ever be able to own a house. They're looking at skyrocketing interest rates and just finding it difficult to make ends meet with daily bills. The thought of actually buying a house is just so far beyond their reach. Add to that the daily reminder of climate catastrophe, and their world's going to come crashing down all around them within their lifetime. And then corrupt governments making strange decisions all around us just seem to make matters worse. You know, the Bible says that without a vision, the people perish. We need a vision. We need something to anchor our hope to. Actually, just a small illustration of what happens if you don't. Without a vision, the people perish. So I had a miserable day yesterday. Tanya's gone off to ladies' camp. And all my children live elsewhere now. And Dad went out with his mates. And I had no plans for my day. And with no plans for my day, and no one around me who usually makes plans for my day, I perished. It was not a good day. You know, and that's just a small illustration of what it's like. If we can see the reality of that in the micro, just of the way you live a day with no vision for what you're trying to accomplish today, no sense of where you're going, no one surrounding you that is going in the same direction, it's not that hard to realise that we had our Bible study on Wednesday night, and I was talking to them about the greatest visionary tool for their finances, their budget. I just heard the collective room go, oh. No, you didn't do it, but you did it inside, I know. Because the word budget strikes fear in most people's hearts, right? But I was explaining to them, no, and a budget is not something that should strike fear in your hearts. A budget is a plan for how you want to use your money. It's setting a vision for where you want your money to go and then living accordingly. We need a vision to live. In the simplest areas of life, we need a vision to live. You need a vision to live. We all need a vision to live. So as we conclude our Daniel series today, I hope that we can see that a vision for life makes it worth living. And without a vision for life, what have we got? A vision for life makes it worth getting up each day. So over the last 3 months, we've heard the stories of Daniel, we've heard the narratives, and we've seen these visions. How did it go? Well, we started with Daniel and his mates being dragged into exile in Babylon, and the culture was going to consume them by turning them into them. And they gave them all the best food of the king. And Daniel and his mates said, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to restrict ourselves. We're going to follow God's way. We're not going to conform to your culture. We're just going to eat a simple lentils and a simple diet. And they allied with their keeper, said, give us a test, and if we come out of it okay, you know, is that going to be okay? And so they did, and we saw them being faithful in a small thing, what they were going to eat. Then we moved on to chapter 2 of Daniel, where the king had had this dream that no one could interpret, no one could understand. And the king was setting out a challenge. He said, I'm not going to tell you what my dream was. You have to tell me what my dream was and then explain it. And then he says, and if you can't, off with your head. He was going to wipe out all of his elite advisors because he was new to the kingdom. It's a good chance, new broom, sweep out all the old chaff. And Daniel makes an approach to the king and he says,
I don't know your dream, O King, but there is a Lord in heaven. He can make known to you the dreams that you sleep in your bed. And Daniel shares that dream and the interpretation with the king. Then what happens? We continued in our story of the fiery furnace. The Nebuchadnezzar was so enamored with this dream that he had of the statue that he decided to make one of himself. And he set up a statue and required that all bow down to it. And these three, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were their Babylonian names, and that was because they were trying to conform them to the culture. Said, no, we're not going to bow to you either. They got drawn before the king, and the king stoked up a fire so hot that the people making the fire were killed. And he said, if you won't bow, you go into the fire. And you know what they said? They said, even if our God doesn't save us, we will not bow to your statue. And the Lord rescued them through the fire, and Nebuchadnezzar saw the power of Almighty God. Then Nebuchadnezzar has another dream of a tree great and powerful, and that it was going to cover the whole earth. Daniel gave him the interpretation of that dream. Belshazzar's feast, we see the writing on the wall. Belshazzar knew, you know, living at large with all of his having a big party with all of his cronies, and he gets the items from the temple that were holy and sacred, and they drink and carouse out of them. And a hand writes on the wall. And he calls Daniel to explain the handwriting on the wall, and Daniel tells him, this very night, your kingdom is going to be taken from you. You're going to die. And then toward the end of Daniel's life, we see him praying three times a day, and those advisors, the king was trying to get rid of, they didn't like Daniel very much because Daniel had shone head and shoulders above them. And so in their attempt to get rid of him, they got the king, Darius at this time, to make an edict that anyone who did not bow and pray to him or bowed and prayed to any other god would be put to death, thrown into a den of lions. And Daniel, of course, wasn't fazed. Looked out his window, praying toward God, the God of his fathers, three times a day. Got called before the king, thrust into the lion's den, and God shut the mouths of the lion. For Daniel, not for the cronies who got thrown in after him. I don't think they lasted very long. And then we've, over the last few weeks, seen these visions of Daniel. We saw him firstly interpret Nebuchadnezzar's dream of the statue with the different parts of its body. And you can see there that Daniel interpreted as, you, O king, you're the gold head, Babylon. It's going to be followed by Persia, Greece, Rome, and then some kind of mixed Rome thing at the end. We've seen that over the last few weeks, and you align that with the prophecies from chapter 10 of the 70 weeks of Daniel, and we see an outline of history that matches. There was going to be a decree to rebuild city and walls. Then the city and walls were rebuilt, and from the time of that decree until the time that the Anointed One comes was a precise number of days, and Jesus rode into Jerusalem, as far as we understand, on the day. And then it says, then the Anointed One will be cut off from the land of the living, put to death. The city and temple will be destroyed, and we know that that happened, AD 70. And then there's this prophecy that later there's going to be this willful king and 7 years of peace covenant, the abomination that causes desolation set up in the middle, a time of great distress. And then we get to this last part of the story. Because up until now, the vision's been a bit bleak. It looks like an awful lot of death and destruction with not much good going on in there. And we get to the last part of the story where the kingdom of God is going to collide with the kingdoms of men. So that's where we've been. That was a very short summary of the last 3 months. But I'm hoping that as we overview it now, just as a final parting thought, we can see this. I thought carefully about these words. Finish faithfully, under powerful protection, until we're raised for reward in God's promised paradise. If we could summarize Daniel, the whole theme, the whole story, the narratives, the visions, the explanations, the prophecies all together, it would be this: finish faithfully, under powerful protection, until we're raised for reward in God's promised paradise. So as we conclude this morning, I'm just going to speak very briefly on those four statements. Finish faithfully. Well, we've already seen Daniel and his friends doing exactly this. What did they do? They persevered in the midst of a culture trying to destroy them. Whether it be food, whether it be fire, whether it be bowing to idols, standing before kings, they persevered. They stayed faithful. They didn't turn their back. They didn't turn around. They didn't go the other way. They didn't hide it. They didn't shun it. They didn't water it down. They finished faithfully. They finished faithfully. You know, in Daniel 3, verse 18, when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were standing before the king and he says, "Bow, or you're going to go in the fire," they said, "We believe in a God who will rescue us. But even if he does not, we won't bow." They'd purposed in their heart there was a bigger story here. And even if they died, they weren't going to bow. Finish faithfully. You know, Daniel, after he'd received these devastating visions of his nation going through torment and turmoil for 600-700 years, actually it's more like 2,600 years, he said he was so overcome, he was unwell, we might say depressed, couldn't get out of bed. But then he came to his senses. He remembered to finish faithfully. Hebrews 12 tells us to run the race with perseverance. You know, a couple of years ago when I was in Adelaide, the church did a series on the measure of spiritual maturity. And we were, as a church, looking at what did it mean to mature as the people of God. And there was a video testimony of a woman from the church that had put the material together. And she had been diagnosed with terminal cancer. And she came up one Sunday to pray, ask the pastor for prayer. She said, "Look, I'd like you to pray for me. I've been diagnosed with terminal cancer." And he said, "Oh, well, what would you like me to pray?" And he was expecting her to say that God would heal me. But you know what she said? "Please pray that I will stay faithful to the end. That as I walk through this ordeal, my faith won't be shaken. I won't question my God. I won't fear. And I won't get angry. I will stay faithful to the end." Now, I heard that story about 12 years ago now, and it has never left me, that we are to finish faithfully. Finish faithfully. You might need that reminder today from the book of Daniel. Don't cave in. Don't give in. stay faithful. The second one was powerful protection. Again, the same narratives. What did we discover in each of those stories and visions from Daniel? We saw God's almighty, supernatural, powerful protection. Whether it be healthier and plumper from eating lentils, who'd do that? Or whether it be surviving a fiery furnace with not a hair on their head singed, not even the smell of smoke on their clothes, or the mouths of the lion shut, or just standing before the king and saying, "This very night you're going to die." Just remember what kind of a king this was. He was pretty quick to put people to death. God powerfully protected them. And Pastor Steve shared with us a couple of weeks ago, the most amazing story is through all of this time of tumult, through the king of the north and the king of the south attacking and this country and that country invading and this empire and that empire going to war and Israel right at the center of it all, God preserved his people. Powerful protection. We have a world that's we have a world that's bent on our destruction. You know, just this week in Canada, there was a woman who was standing silently in front of a Planned Parenthood clinic. Those are the places that legalized abortions take place. She was just standing. There was a video of her just standing quietly in front. And the police came and asked her what was she doing. And she said, "I'm just praying." They said, "You can't do that here." And they arrested her. She wasn't shouting. She wasn't speaking. She wasn't going anywhere near the clinic. She was on the other side of the road, standing silently, praying, and she was arrested. Because that's now considered a hate crime. We live in a world that is bent on conforming us to their image. Apparently, you can't pray silently where you stand anymore. You may feel that the world is bent on your destruction, that the world is trying to conform you to its pattern. But remember, God is powerfully protecting you, preserving you in the midst of it all. But here's the sad bit. They all died. Well, didn't they? Daniel, he died. Every person has lived their life and died. There's only two that we know of that didn't. Enoch, who walked with God, and Elijah, who was taken up in a chariot, and of course Jesus, who died and rose from the dead. But everybody else, even Lazarus, who was risen after he died, he's not still wandering around somewhere. If he is, he's doing a good job of hiding. They all died. So if that's not what God's powerful protection is about, stopping us from dying, what is it about? Preservation. Preservation unto what? Hebrews 11 speaks of Daniel and says exactly what it's about. Hebrews 11, verse 13 to 16. You know I like this passage. I go to Hebrews 11 a lot. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own.
If they'd been thinking of the country they'd left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. This is the passage, Hebrews 11, that says all the things that happened to people and says, shut the mouths of lions. He's including Daniel as he speaks of all these others who died. So, last week, we saw that we're all going to be raised. That's what Daniel 12 was all about. The resurrection at the end of all things. Daniel 12, 13, listen, as you go your way till the end, listen, you will rest. He's saying, Daniel, you're going to die. And all of us go, well, duh, we're all going to die. So what is it we're trusting in God's powerful protection for? More than just whether we die or not. Then he says, and then at the end of days, you will rise to receive your allotted inheritance. So I've got two key points for this. The first thing he said was, go your way, Daniel. Go your way. Now, I've just got to find Jeremiah. He always hides in my Bible. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 4 to 7. As the people went into exile, this is what God said through the prophet Jeremiah as they went into exile in Babylon. Verse 4 to 7. This is what the Lord God Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile. Build houses, settle down, plant gardens, eat what they produce, marry, have sons and daughters, find wives for your sons, give daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons. For your son, increase the number there, do not decrease. Seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you in exile. Pray to the Lord, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. He said, go your way, Daniel. Live life. Live a rich life. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life to the full, a life of abundance. Not merely or only in material, but in the fullness and richness of everything that God has provided for us. He says, don't close down in a holy huddle. Don't go hide in a cave awaiting for the kingdom of God. Live. Live to the full. After Daniel's terrifying visions, he was depressed. He lay in bed. He lost his hope, but he was reminded of a city and a kingdom that was not made with human hands. He got up, and it tells us that he went about the king's business, got on with his full, rich, vibrant life in the king of Babylon's court. Go your way, God said, get on with it. You're living for something bigger. You've got a vision that goes beyond the torment that you've just seen in these terrifying visions of the future. Go live. Live with a purpose. And then I think we see, live like it matters. There's an inheritance that's given. We read it in Daniel 12, verse 13. And at the end of days, you will rise and receive your allotted inheritance. We think of inheritance as the passing on of the family possessions in a will. But actually, the Bible's idea of the inheritance goes a lot further than that. You know, we can live, you know, Christians going to church. We know we're going to heaven because of the finished work of Christ. We hang on to that really tightly, but we don't necessarily all go all in. We can live in many ways like the rest of the world, just doing what we want with a kind of Christian veneer painted over the surface. You know, we go to church, we do our Bible studies and so on, but we haven't been consumed
with a vision that goes beyond just what we do here and now. So I want to just very quickly remind you that this inheritance, this thing that we receive at, or that Daniel was being told was going to be received at the end, is something worthwhile. What did Jesus say? He said, "Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you." The angel said to Daniel, "Go your way and you'll be raised your inheritance." But what is it? Daniel wasn't given much light as to what the inheritance was. We see a little bit more explanation of it. There are crowns that are mentioned in the scriptures. We're not going to go into them in any great detail at all. Crowns for various contributions to life, like the imperishable crown, the rejoicing, crown of rejoicing, the crown of righteousness, the crown of glory, the crown of life. These are apparently going to be given to the faithful when they're raised to their inheritance. Jesus spoke of, "In my Father's house there are many mansions. I've created a place for you." It's part of the inheritance that's promised. And in the parable of the talents, Jesus makes it clear that the king's going to give us all something, and he's going to go away, and he's going to come back and see what we did with what we were given. And then he's going to make decisions based on what we did with what we were given. There's a challenge to us that gives us a purpose, it gives us a reason, it gives us a way to live our lives. It's not just about whether we live forever. There's so much more than that. He says we're going to be raised unto reward, and it should affect the way we live. I often say, you can't follow a God, you don't know what he said, did, or taught. We need to know God's ways. And what did we say? What was the very first thing that we need to finish faithfully? What does that mean? We live for the kingdom of God, for the coming kingdom of God. The Apostle Paul, reflecting probably on Daniel's understanding in 1 Corinthians 9:27, says that he beats his body. He buffets it. He puts it under subjection because he's concerned that after preaching everything that he's preached to everyone else, that he himself might be found a castaway. Some say, well, that was the Apostle Paul saying that he might have lost his salvation. Not after he just wrote the book on not losing your salvation, Romans chapter 8. Nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. There is no condemnation to those who are in Christ. No one can take us out of the Father's hands, Jesus says. No, no, that wasn't what he was thinking. He was thinking about the inheritance for the faithful when we are resurrected. And it's not the same for everybody. 1 Peter 1 verse 4 teaches us that our inheritance is kept. It's protected for us in heaven by God. It's guaranteed, but we should live like it matters. The coming kingdom of God is worth living for. And the final thought is the promised paradise. We hear of it, we've read all those scriptures that spoke of it this morning, the kingdom of God. We think we know what it means, but there are at least five different chapters in the book of the kingdom of God. Sometimes it looks like a spiritual thing, sometimes it looks like a physical thing, sometimes it looks like an all of the universe thing that God's sovereign over, sometimes it looks like a monarchical thing where the king of Israel ruled from Saul to Zedekiah, who was taken off in exile to Babylon. So the kingdom of God somehow has all these different chapters to the book.
there's at least a physical kingdom of God. In fact, it's so obvious that there is at least a physical kingdom of God. You cannot read the Bible and come to any other conclusion except by making it say something it doesn't say. David was promised that he was going to rule, and someone's going to rule on his throne forever. It goes right, this promise of the forever kingdom of God, it was the hope that the people had when Jesus showed up on the scene. It was what they were expecting him to do. In fact, one of the disciples actually said in Acts 1, when Jesus was talking to them just before he ascended to heaven, they said, is it now you're going to set up your kingdom, drive the Romans from us, and rule forever? And Jesus never corrected them and said, no, well, actually, there's not a physical kingdom. It's just a spiritual kingdom. He said, no, it's not for you to know the times and seasons. Jesus did not disagree. In fact, when the Pharisees were putting him on trial in Mark 14:62, they say, are you the Messiah? Jesus says, I am, and you will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven. He didn't say there wasn't going to be a physical kingdom. He said there is going to be a physical kingdom. There's at least going to be a physical kingdom. There is, of course, a spiritual kingdom. Christ is ruling in our hearts by faith now. And, of course, then there's another one that we sometimes confuse, the eternal state, heaven, the forever. These are all the things we're talking about when we talk about the kingdom of God. But from Daniel 2, 7 and 12, we see that the major theme of Daniel is the coming kingdom of God. You know, when the angels interrupted the shepherds in the fields when Jesus came, was going to be born, they said, peace and goodwill to all mankind. They were declaring the coming kingdom of God. When the angel Gabriel spoke to Mary in Luke 1:32, he says, the angel says of Jesus, he shall sit on the throne of David and reign forever. And what did Jesus say in Matthew chapter 6? He said, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When Jesus taught us to pray, a prayer that many repeat every day of their lives, like a ritual, they're praying, your kingdom come. This is what they're praying for. It's a vision. It's a future. It's a promise. It's a reason to live. It's a reason to really live. This is what we're praying for. Daniel teaches us that God's kingdom is the reason we live. And when we pray, your kingdom come, we're praying along with Daniel for the physical resurrection unto a reward in paradise promised by a king. So, what does Daniel show us about this kingdom of God? It tells us that the Messiah, the Son of Man, is coming on the clouds of heaven, and Jesus reaffirmed that. It tells us that he's going to judge the Antichrist and the nations. It tells us that he's going to put an end to suffering for Israel and all the nations. He tells us of he's going to physically, eternally raise the believing dead. The New Testament tells us that's called the first resurrection. The faithful are going to receive their inheritance. We would call that rewards. And the Messiah will reign over the earth. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's what Daniel teaches us of the coming kingdom. How's it sound to you? Sound pretty good? Well, then we've got what the rest of the Bible teaches us, Old Testament, about the coming kingdom. Micah tells us that we'll be taught directly by God himself. He teaches us that God will resolve all disputes. He tells us that God's going to put an end to all war. Isaiah tells us that we're going to have everlasting joy. Revelation would say he's going to wipe every tear from our eyes. He says that all iniquity will be pardoned. Now listen to this one, this is amazing. He's going to give us a double blessing, and I read that passage and thought about it. I could go into that passage in great detail because it's a double blessing according to our sins that have been forgiven. I don't even know what to make of that. We will fully know God, Habakkuk tells us. We will know him, and the New Testament tells us we shall see him. We will know him, for we shall see him as he really is. You know, the only thing that the book of Revelation tells us about this coming kingdom of God that isn't in the Old Testament is how long it's going to last. It's the only thing, the only detail that Revelation adds that we can't find elsewhere in the Bible. Revelation tells us it's 1,000 years. That's why we call it the millennial reign of Christ or the millennium. But Daniel didn't know that, so forget about the 1,000 years because we're only doing Daniel. A rock destroys all previous kingdoms and grows to cover the whole earth is what Daniel told us. This promise motivated the nation of Israel in the midst of strife. When they were overcome by the Greek army and Antiochus Epiphanes, the promise of God's kingdom motivated them to retake the temple and rededicate it. It was the expectation of the people when Jesus arrived on the scene. So, what do we get out of Daniel? Finish faithfully. We're all probably going to die. Unless the Lord returns in the next couple of years, we all could well die. Finish faithfully under powerful protection and inheritance that is kept in heaven by God for you until we are raised in unto that heavenly reward, that kingdom that God's promised, his promised paradise. Maybe the finish faithfully is the challenge for you. Yeah, I might have just gone a little bit soft around the edges. I might have compromised on things I wish I hadn't. I might have gone down the wrong path a few too many times. Finish faithfully. You're not finished yet. Or maybe you thought, well, God doesn't really care about what's going on. He is powerfully protecting you. Or maybe you don't really have a reason to live. Yeah, I'm going to heaven. But he says, take what I've given you and use it. Live to the full and use it for my kingdom. Seek first my kingdom and my righteousness. Because we are headed from a promised paradise. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for this challenge from the book of Daniel to finish faithfully, to hold firmly to your promised protection, because we have a vision that we will be raised to reward in your promised paradise. Help us to live that out in everyday life. Help us to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness. We pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we say, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. Make straight a highway, come for the Lord.
bride.
Like a bride waiting for her groom, will you stand ready for you? Every heart longing for a king, please, even so, for Jesus born, even so.
Ask that you will help us, Lord. You'll give us the strength to be faithful, to wait faithfully for you, to finish faithfully, Lord, with your powerful protection until we're raised for rewards in your promised paradise. Amen.
Now your freedom is all that I know. I ran out of that grip, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. I needed rescue, my soul was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of faith. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.